Welcome to There's Sometimes a Buggy, Irresponsible Opinions About Classic Film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave. This week, it's a K. Francis double feature as part of our Hollywood Studios Year by Year, 1937 Warner Brothers. We'll be talking about Confession and Stolen Holiday.
Well, here we are again with your favorite actress, K. Francis.
It's going to be great. But before we do any discussion of the films, as is our wont these days, first I'm going to go into my Hollywood Studios book and familiarize our listenership with the stars at Warner Brothers in 1937.
Oh my.
Are you ready, Elise?
I'm ready. Is everyone ready?
I hope so. In the final year of her contract, Joan Blondell, Edward G. Robinson, Betty Davis, Kay Francis, Paul Muni, Dick Powell, Humphrey Bogart, just getting started, Pat O'Brien, Olivia de Havilland, Errol Flynn, Claude Rains, Anne Sheridan, just getting started as well, and Jane Wyman and Ronald Reagan. Notice anyone missing, Elise?
No, because I was looking at the stars, the number of stars.
People out there might have asked themselves, where is James Cagney?
That's a good question, isn't it?
He was, in fact, at Grand National Pictures in 1936 and 37, an upstart that went belly up, and Cagney came back and became a star once again for Warner Brothers.
Oh, yes, I see. His arrow is short.
Well, there's a gray stretch.
Yeah, there's a gray streak there, yes. K. Francis only has two stars, but then so does Joan Blondell, who you'd think would have been...
No, that's right, I think.
A good star for them.
So this is from Joel W. Findler's The Hollywood Story, and they do give 3, 2, or 1, or no stars to... the people that they put on their contract chart. And basically what they're saying is, how bankable were these stars? That's all they're saying. So
Olivia de Havilland, only 2 stars. That's startling.
Well, I think that that's accurate for her time at Warner Brothers because she was always second billed. You know, she was not carrying movies.
Rin Tin Tin, only 2 stars. Now that's truly mind-boggling. I thought the dog acts were always big.
Yeah, that seems a little bit unfair to Rin Tin Tin, actually. But I think it is accurate in terms of what they've given to Kay Francis, not in terms of quality, because I think she is 3-star quality. But her films didn't do well at Warner Brothers. They brought her on with a giant contract. We've talked about this several times. They stole her from Paramount, thinking that they were getting in on a great thing, and it turned out to be an albatross around their neck contractually. But the movies did not suffer. As far as I'm concerned, she made movie after movie that is just amazing.
Now, both of these are what, yeah, we can comfortably call B movies, although they've got some A talent involved, but we'll talk about who was involved as we talk about the individual movies. Are you going to give your readings now?
I am indeed. Clive Hirshhorn's The Warner Brothers Story. Kay Francis, playing a singer, endured almost as much as her audiences in Confession. An unashamedly melodramatic film, it had its heroine performing in sidewalk cafes when, at the very least, she should have been gracing the opera houses of Europe. Not only that, but when she finds evil Basil Rathbone, who was once responsible for separating her from her husband and little girl, making advances to the same little girl, who isn't so little anymore, she kills him. All too silly for words, especially Julius J. Epstein and Margaret Leveno's words. Story by Hans Rameau. and for Joe Mai's limited directorial talents. Hal Wallace produced, Henry Blankey supervised, and the cast included Ian Hunter, Donald Crisp, Jane Bryan, Mary McGuire, Dorothy Peterson, Laura Hope Cruz, and Vita Ann Borg. Song, 1 Hour of Romance, was written by Jack Scholl and Peter Clouder. So, Clive Hirschhorn detested this film, clearly.
If he even actually saw it. You don't see a lot at any of the studios of B women's pictures.
Well, I think you do at Warner Brothers.
Do you? Who else?
Well, like
does
them? Glenda Farrell, Joan Blondell.
Yeah, but I mean women's melodramas. Those are more comedies, aren't they?
Well, those are comedies. Sure, okay, but that's really getting specific. You want B melodramas, then.
B women's melodramas.
Because Warner Brothers
or
also...
Or women's pictures, or however specifically you're supposed to refer to it.
You know, they did build a lot of B pictures around female stars. Nancy Drew, Torchy Blaine. They had a bunch of these series.
Yep, but the woman's picture, that's one you don't see as much, I feel.
No,
that's...
but you certainly see them in these Kay Francis movies.
Something unique here. B pictures are something... Of course, you're right. There were all sorts of serials that were B pictures, and many of them were built around women, but usually we associate B pictures with, you know, film noir and things like that.
Sure. So this film is a direct shot-for-shot remake of Mazurka.
That's correct. So Joe Mai and the director of Mazurka, Willy Forst, both Austrian film directors. Presumably that's why Joe Mai was chosen for this project when Warners acquired the rights. Why he decided to do a shot-for-shot remake, Wikipedia does not reveal to us.
I guess he just thought it looked cool, and why not do it again? See if he could recreate it in Hollywood as an experiment.
He does, by doing that, he gets away with making something that is very, very odd in the Hollywood context. And it's more odd in that... It feels like an exercise or an experiment. It doesn't even feel like his own film shot this way organically. You know what I mean? What it reminded me of the most was something like René's Melo.
Sure, which is also a remake of a remake.
Yeah, and which is specifically a movie that he made to see if he could recapture the emotions that a standard, like a classic of French melodrama had inspired in him as a young man. I can't remember exactly how old he was, but I don't know. It feels like something like that. Yeah, the effect is kind of simultaneously Lynchian and Brechtian. And it does feel very B-movie-ish, but then because, you know, the sets are kind of limited and the cinematography is limited, although the shots are interesting because they're not standard Hollywood shots.
Well, Clive Hirschhorn did not approve.
But as the momentum gets going, apparently the same music was used as well.
Yeah.
By the time she's showing up at Basil Rathbone's room
to tell him to stop bothering her
in her cape, in her melodrama cape, right? And the music is going, and then there's the nice shadows from the staircase on the wall, and she confronts him, and then the husband shows up at the door, and then she's chasing through the streets after the husband. That whole sequence, it's like everything comes together, and suddenly this movie is cooking. And despite the Brechtian alienation of these kind of very flat, very American performances in the midst of this madness, I feel like the points where it has to hit the emotion, it actually does manage to. The self-sacrificing mother moments.
That's right. I think Kay Francis delivers the goods here.
So what's Lynchian about it, obviously, is the way Mai, certainly, and perhaps Willy Forst, we won't know unless we see the original,
yeah,
how they pair this scenario down to the bare archetypes. And the reading that I give to it is that this woman who acts like a psychopath in this movie, like she's out of her fucking mind, is split. Obviously, she's split between not Basil Rathbone and her husband, played by Ian Hunter, but between this desire for a career and the desire to be a wife and mother that she has completely consciously imbibed. And she doesn't believe that she has any other relevant desires. And this is what causes her to become a psychopath and take everything out on Basil Rathbone, although he is also, you know, a symbol of a certain kind of patriarchy. But patriarchy is interesting in this film too, because all of the real power holders of it end up being on her side quite implausibly at the end. end.
That may not be an inaccurate representation of
how patriarchy works.
Sure, if you've got someone who's kind of on the outside, obviously Basil Rathbone is not a member of the real top shelf boys club. He's a weirdo.
Well, he's a famous artist, but
sure, but they don't respect that. He's just a creepy rapist, basically. That's what he is. They don't need to protect him.
No, that's true.
So they don't. They take her side. They take the side of outraged motherhood.
Right, because she performs that role so well because she believes it so psychotically herself.
Yes.
That this is the only thing she is and wants and can be.
Well, because it's what was taken from her.
Well, she's psychotic about it from the beginning, about motherhood and wifehood.
Maybe, but she might have gotten used to it and settled in, except that she was robbed of that opportunity by these circumstances.
What I mean by psychotic is the extent of her belief that this is the only role she can occupy. It's the only role she believes she wants to occupy.
That's right. We should talk a bit about the structure of the film. It's a Kay Francis starring vehicle, but she doesn't show up for a really long time.
Sure.
Because we're actually following the adventures of Jane Bryan, an up-and-coming star at Warner Brothers, who was really poised to start doing amazing things. 1939's We Are Not Alone really shows what she was capable of by then.
But then,
then she got married and retired.
She married, yeah, ironically, given the movie's theme that we were just talking about.
Yeah.
She married a businessman who ended up being responsible for the Rexall drugs franchise.
Right. Yeah, I knew it was some big concern he was involved with.
What does it say here? Businessman and entrepreneur, Justin Dart.
But we'll see her. She turns up fairly often in Warner Brothers movies in 37, 38, and 39. She's in The Sisters, which we'll be watching in the next group of Warner Brothers films.
In this movie, she acts like a piece of wood, and it's perfect. She seems like a real B-movie lead.
Well, that's what she was at this time,
right? Like a Nancy Drew.
It's true. She stars in Girls on Probation, which is another noirish melodrama starring a woman.
That also makes everything feel very Lynchian, because Lynch likes to use flat B-movie or TV-type performances strategically in many of his movies.
Well, wait till you see her in We Are Not Alone. She is so great in that movie.
But she gets better.
They just ask her to do more.
Yes, exactly. Yeah.
She's the star of that movie with Paul Muni. So, but here, the first third of the film, she is the protagonist, and she is swept up into the evil world of Basil Rathbone. Egged on by her sidekick,
yeah,
who then disappears and leaves Jane Bryan holding the Rathbone.
Let's talk about the archetypal scenario, which is that this girl's mother goes away.
Yes, Dorothy Peterson.
There is a warm parting. She cannot bear, although she's at the conservatory, she must be around 20 years old, or 19 or 20.
Maybe a little younger, but yes, basically an adult.
She cannot bear to be away from her mother and says that she has never been, they've never been parted before.
She calls her mummy.
But, of course, as soon as the mother is out of the picture, that means that naughty adventures can happen. Not that she wants them to, but
Her
sidekick id encourages her. Yeah, the plot requires her to have adventures at this point. The adventure is a very B-movie-ish type adventure in that a handsome, mysterious, talented older man is making aggressive advances toward her. Comes on like Stefan in Letter from an Unknown Woman. Until I saw you, I had this terrible feeling of aloneness, but now it's gone.
A question the movie does not answer is, does Basil Rathbone know that Jane Bryan is Kay Francis's daughter?
Well, they don't look or seem anything alike. I don't think he has any reason. It's just all a terrible melodrama coincidence that seals his fate, I think. Divine punishment.
Right, that he's just drawn to
the woman who's going to get him killed, yeah, I think.
Could be. Prefer to think of it that way. But he seems to be, he's just stalking her, right? But I guess, yeah, he just saw her at the conservatory and that's it. Because the other possibility is that he looked her up just the way Kay Francis did, found out who she is. She's the daughter, the long-lost daughter.
I don't feel like he's that obsessed with Kay Francis. I think he's probably moved on since then to many other women like this.
Well, that's true. And the way he just runs away as soon as Kay Francis looks at him.
But he sees
her. He's not ready to face her. He's not ready to challenge her. He wants to put that behind him.
The shock on his face?
That was actually pretty amazing. He's like, this place is making me very uncomfortable right now.
We just watched the remake of Le Jour se lève. Kiev, The Long Night, directed by Anatole Litvak. And it is not shot-by-shot remake, but there are a lot of shots borrowed for it from Le Jour Se Lève. And so I was getting that kind of vibe off of Basil Rathbone's character as well. The Vincent Price stalking of the fresh young virgin and her dreamy, ambiguous desires in relation to him.
Sure, there's definitely a connection there.
This whole first part of the movie is in itself interesting, in that you think this girl is going to have this adventure, and exactly how creepy and dangerous is this man going to turn out to be, basically, is the question, which is only answered when Kay Francis comes on the scene.
She steps up with her flashback and shows that he is not averse to a little rape, for sure.
But initially, I am, you know, a little bit torn. I'm kind of on the side of this adventure as the daughter, what's her name?
Lisa.
As Lisa starts getting into it, you know, even though I know it's a bad idea for her in that society and in a movie of this type, to fall for Basil Rathbone, you're still kind of on the side of this being fun for her,
she
maybe.
She keeps seeing that chandelier.
Yeah, so obviously one of the experimental aspects of this film is that it uses a lot of subjective point of view shots. One would already be more than are typically used in Hollywood films at this time. But
certainly Warner Brothers films.
Quite a few. And then we get, first of all, we get the scene in the cafe, which is extremely blue velvet-ish. Kay Francis in a wig in a nightclub singing a nightclub song badly.
Right, using her real voice, clearly.
Yeah, because she's got her speech impediment. I mean, I'm sure it was like, if Marlene Dietrich can do this, I can do this, because they both have bad voices and speech impediments.
Right. Now, when she sings opera in the flashback, that is clearly not her voice. But when her voice goes, it turns into her real voice.
And yeah, it's fantastic how she sees Basil Rathbone, he freaks out, and she passes out. And we have no idea why initially, right? On a first viewing, you have no idea why.
A genre veteran will know that there is a flashback coming that will tell us all about their dealings in the past. But no, we don't know exactly what transpired between them.
But when I was researching Le Jour Se Lève, it is sometimes credited as being the first flashback structure.
Well, no, that's
film.
Of course, that's not right, because there's The Power and the Glory in 1933. Right. I mean, there's all kinds of flashbacks.
And predating, specifically that's raised in order to say that this predates Citizen Kane. But obviously plenty of films were using this structure from the silent era on, I'm sure.
Yeah.
But it's still relatively rare before the film noir era of the 1940s.
Yeah, it becomes much more common. That's undoubtedly true. And Le Jour Se Lève might have had something to do with that.
And obviously, this being a sort of expressionistic melodrama with these highly archetypal characters, it does seem to foreshadow American noir in some ways.
Yeah. Well, there are a lot of foreshadowings, right? It's not just poetic realism that feeds into the American noir. Certainly the gangster film and other crime melodramas of the 1930s.
Yeah,
you could see intimations of noir in a lot of those movies. Anything Fritz Lang was doing, you can certainly see it too.
And Carnet himself was influenced by German expressionism.
Right, and by American film. And certainly Prévert as well.
Yeah, German films were influenced by American crime film and so on and so forth.
Yeah, there's a lot of cross-pollination.
And Joe Mai,
this is our second Joe Mai film, because we did Music in the Air a little while back.
Joe Mai, who mainly worked as a B-movie director, and this is considered one of his most interesting works in America, also, it seems, from his Wikipedia entry, mainly worked as a director of serials.
Yeah, I think that's right.
In,
like, adventure serials, right?
Yeah, in Germany. Although he also directed melodramas starring his wife, Mia Mai, whose name he took.
Cool.
So we do get our flashback.
Yes, and we start to get a little bit better understanding of why this shooting took place. Kay Francis, this is during World War I, as an opera star. She's involved with a company of players, which includes Basil Rathbone, who is a Lothario. He's always dating someone in the cast, but putting the moves on others. And he's really centered on trying to win Kay Francis over.
Well, this
mostly because she's engaged to someone else and she's not accessible to him, it seems.
This backstage scene, after we see the operetta, where she's singing about feeling like losing her soul, this backstage scene is where my reading begins. She keeps asserting to him that all she wants out of life to be is a wife and mother, and there's nothing she will regret about giving up her career, and he keeps asserting that she will miss it. And it's at this point, it seems to me that his seduction becomes in her mind all mixed up with this career that she cannot consciously acknowledge that she regrets giving up.
Yeah.
We also meet her husband, whom she worships as like the ideal man.
He's a very solid individual, Ian Hunter. They made 8 movies together, Kay Francis and Ian Hunter.
But he talks about how he was feeling so jealous watching her on the stage with an actor. So obviously it's his sexual jealousy, as so often in movies of this era, about men demanding that their wives give up their jobs so that you're not going to circulate in the world of men and have sex with them and get pregnant by them.
Right. But he's also a little more understanding than usual, as you would expect from Ian Hunter, because he does say, you know, are you sure you're really ready to give up all of this just to marry me?
Yeah, but I think her options are to marry him or to give it up.
I agree. I don't think that he's really giving her a chance, but he's acknowledging that it's a tough choice, whereas most male brutes in these movies just say, well, you were just waiting for me to come along to make you get married, and that's it.
But she is here is her psychotic insistence, and the movie's psychotic insistence that nowhere in her mind can it become conscious that she has any desire other than to sacrifice herself to become a wife and mother.
Yeah, that's true. And I think that that's fairly period accurate as well. It was really hard for women to just tell everyone and themselves they wanted to do both.
Yeah, but I mean, I think that is the subtextual meaning of the whole movie.
I agree. Yeah, I mean, that's what this movie's exploring.
And interestingly, Blue Velvet is more in the territory of the mother whore complex.
Yeah,
of,
I don't
of the
think...
split between the idealized mother and wife figure and this dark and broken figure. It's more, and prostitute figure. It's more something like playing off something like Blonde Venus.
Yes. There's no way David Lynch was thinking about gender roles interfacing with the work world in Blue Velvet.
But he is, I think he is a little bit in Inland Empire.
Maybe, but not in Blue Velvet.
In Inland Empire, there's more of, I feel like, Laura Dern's character, among the many things she's exploring internally, is, well, being a wife and mother versus being a whore, but also versus being an actress in general.
Yes.
Like having her own inner life versus fully occupying the role of mother and wife.
Yeah, I agree.
So, back to this movie.
We see her in the early stages of the marriage. She's had a baby. Turns out to be little Lisa, and her husband's away at the war.
Yeah, and Basil Rathbone just keeps showing up and tormenting her, just like this career that she won't acknowledge is haunting her.
Yeah, and he gives away the game. He says, you know, I'm going to get you eventually, even if I have to compromise you. He just states it flatly.
And yet, this does not make her unduly cautious.
No, because she feels like she can handle him, and when she's sober, she clearly can.
Yeah, but nobody goes to a party, like the one that he secretly invites her to. Nobody goes to a party and gets that smashed unless they are very unhappy with their lives in
right.
some way.
Well, her husband's away, and everyone's telling her she's overdoing this mother thing.
Right, which again supports the thesis that something's wrong with her relationship to motherhood, that she's overcompensating for not really being into it.
Yeah, I agree. Or she seems to be into it, but not into it to the exclusion of everything else.
That's what I mean. Not as into it as she thinks she must be. Like, 1,000%.
Yeah, the doctor says, go out, baby's fine.
Yeah, but of course, that's a catch-22 situation, because if she does go out, then she gets blamed for it, as is about to happen.
That's true.
So you can't, if you overdo it, and if you don't overdo it, either way, you're going to be fucked as a mother in this world.
The servants are watching. Everyone's paying attention to your movements.
Everybody's a superego.
That's right.
Now, my thesis seemed totally confirmed at this party at the point at which she's about midway drunk and suddenly she bursts into her song. It's like she's sitting there in that chair and she becomes possessed by this artist self that she won't acknowledge.
Certainly nothing about Basil Rathbone.
Mm-mm.
I mean, she didn't know he invited her. She likes hanging out with everyone else. He just unfortunately happens to be there.
The whole team starts singing the opera again, even though they all claim they don't like it, that it's not actually very good, because I guess Basil Rathbone wrote it.
Right. They hate him.
Right.
Laura Hope Cruz is her best friend amongst that group, the older lady, who tells Rathbone off a few times. She unfortunately gets drunk to the point where she cannot defend herself from the predatory advances of Rathbone.
And then we get a whole bunch of subjective shots of her drunken state and of the door and of the hallway when he takes her back to his apartment. Usually I'm quite alert to any rape subtext, but it didn't occur to me. There was no suggestion that sex occurred and he could compromise her just as well whether he raped her or not. She's basically raped just by staying there in the eyes of patriarchy.
Yeah, that's true, but I think the movie just makes it feel like, you know, this guy added crime to his other misdemeanors or intended misdemeanors.
Or he could have just, because he keeps pestering her after this, so he could have just compromised her by her staying there in the hope that that will require her to come back to him voluntarily.
Maybe. I mean, that's...
You can read it either way. It's a blank. It's an actual ape. This door that she keeps seeing subjectively, this is like an aporia, so you can read it either way.
It's true. We don't know exactly what happened, and she doesn't remember, but she fears the worst.
Again, she knows the worst has happened just by the fact that she's been compromised.
And then even worse, Leonid comes home. She's resolved to tell him all about it, but before she can, she notices he's missing an arm, and he's now going to be even more fragile than he was before, and she just can't do it. And she's summoned once again to Rathbone, and she feels like she has to heed the summons before Ian Hunter intercepts one of these phone calls or letters he keeps sending. That leads to her being caught in the act of just being in Rathbone's apartment, and that's...
Which is enough. She also mentions... a little later, when she's talking to the lawyer, I guess, that her husband has been a nervous wreck. And so that's why he would also be, you know, not in any mood to listen to any explanations.
Yeah, well, he's shot up.
We don't get to actually see any of that because the movie is so focused on her, but that's what she reports of him.
Well, I think they do a decent job. The scene doesn't focus on them for very long, but all you need is one breakfast scene to get a sense of what's going on there. They're not talking. He thinks it's because he's no longer a man. And she's not interested in him at all, and
she's guilty.
She's preoccupied, so she can't even help him with his worries.
Well, she's not only guilty, but she's also fearing that she'll be exposed because Rathbone keeps pestering her.
Yeah, and she knows the servants saw she came home the next morning,
right?
And any moment one of them could just start talking about it. It's a terrible predicament to be in, and the camera follows her to her doom, which...
Very stylish doom.
Yeah, Ian Hunter follows her waiting outside Rathbone's apartment. You know, it's a moment of triumph where she successfully beats down Rathbone. He gives up, or he signals his defeat, and...
So this is actually very intricately constructed, this screenplay. Willie Forrest was mainly known for his musical films. As I said, this is a very intricate construction because there's also the aporia of who came to the door earlier when mother and daughter were together in the pre-flashback section of the film.
Yes. Jane Bryan is getting a new dress to announce her ascension into womanhood.
Yeah, that's what you want, a new dress, not Basil Rathbone.
In the middle of all of that, the doorbell rings, and Dorothy Peterson, when she comes back from the door, she looks a little shaken.
Yes.
So what happened there?
So we only find that out after we've gone back to the courtroom at the end of the flashback. So revisited the whole shooting, spotting a Basil Rathbone and shooting from her perspective.
The way the movie puts it all together, you do get for quite a long time Kay Francis just staring down the judges and the lawyers and the public, standing mute, refusing to give any context for this act. All she did was yell out Rathbone's name and shoot him in the back. And that's her final statement on the matter. Do what you want with me. That's all I have to say. But then they find a suitcase.
Right. And this is where we get the flashback.
Right.
At the end of all, and they send the public away. At the end of all of this, she, well, we know that she was protecting her daughter, who was taken away from her when she was revealed to be this fallen woman.
Yeah, I mean, it's a terrible set of circumstances that would unhinge almost anyone. They, on the day that they have their Stella Dallas moment, where they go to visit their daughter and realize that they really can't be part of their life anymore because the daughter is placed with a more socially acceptable mother now.
Well, no, this is brilliant. Okay, no, I love this scene. This is my favorite scene in the whole movie.
It is great. Yes.
Where the two mothers confront each other.
Dorothy Peterson is a great actress.
And Dorothy Peterson is the woman that Kay Francis wants to be.
Yes.
She actually does love and fully and naturally, at least to the external eye, inhabit the role of mother. She is not split. She is not divided. And Kay Francis herself at this point has become just this outcast
beer hall chanter.
Yeah, blue velvet figure. So she is the antithesis of motherhood at this point. She's gone way far in the other direction from what she wanted to go in.
She's got a blonde wig and very hollowed out eyes, all done by makeup. I think the makeup's pretty good. Like, she's...
It's very expressionistic, and yeah, it worked very well. Yeah, it was very stylized. I liked it. Yeah, so these two women, who are both wholly sympathetic, confront each other.
And an understanding develops between them. Kay Francis never says in so many words that I am the mother, but I think Dorothy Peterson figures it out.
And there's just this one shot of her looking at the two of them together with the dress. That's the first point at which all of this kind of distant, stylized melodrama really finds an emotional focal point, right? It works very well.
Well, it's like Barbara Stanwyck watching Anne Shirley through the window.
Yeah.
In Stella Dallas, which came out the same year.
And yeah, but very different style. Not with this kind of stylization and distance.
And the very day that all of this wonderful stuff happened, which Kay Francis tells us later when she's describing it, she says, you know, I could stop worrying now. I could stop being upset about my daughter. I know that she is on track for a good life. After all of that, then she looks up from her singing and sees all of that's going to go for nothing because she's about to get assaulted by the suave Basil Rathbone up in the nosebleed seats. And she just can't handle it. No, this can't happen again.
I guess if you take it that Basil Rathbone raped her, then he deserves what he gets.
Well, I think so.
But he also, with or without that, does become the victim of this maniac that patriarchy has turned her into because of her inability to become a whole person with all of these different sides of herself together. You know, the fact that she has to deny so much about herself has turned her into this monster of motherhood. Basically. And he's just mowed down. And then the system also decides that that's all right. They keep going, you killed a human being, you killed a human being. But once they find out that she did it in the name of motherhood, so in the service of patriarchy, then it's okay.
Exactly. It's more valuable.
She is the agent of patriarchy, and she ends up destroying the useless rapist, Basil Rathbone, that nobody cares about.
Yeah. All he can father are illegitimate children. So he's no good. It's much more valuable to keep motherhood in place than to keep that kind of guy around. You only get a couple of years and you'll be pardoned very shortly.
But because of your own devotion to the ideal of motherhood, what you will never have is a relationship with your daughter.
Of course. Well, that's always a big part of these sacrifice movies, and it always works, right? Because it shows you the cost of true belief. And then she does get to say goodbye to her daughter.
Oh, yeah, and then the
there's a ghostly hug.
The double exposure ghost, which I guess is also in the original film.
The kind of thing that you get in Fritz Lang as well.
Yeah,
Testament of Dr. Mabuse. A very different
effect, yes.
Right? But it's the same thing. It's the astral body doing...
The Empire of Crime.
That's right. Instead of the Empire of Crime, it's the Empire of Motherhood giving a demonstration of maternal affection. But in the real world, it's just a very terse goodbye there. But Jane Bryan knows that whatever the reason, this was done for her own good, and she accepts it. And she realizes that she was about to get into some deep waters with Basil Rathbone.
In over her head, yes. Yeah. So she does not regret that her hymen was saved from the wrath of Bone. So, yeah, I mean, I'd like to see the original film, which starred Pola Negri, but this film has its own interest simply by being put into a Hollywood context and being such a different approach to melodrama from what Hollywood was doing in its A pictures, something like Stella Dallas, and yet it's still very effective.
It is, and I think, you know, just another great way to see that Kay Francis can do anything that's asked of her.
Yeah, it's a very Lynchian performance in that she has to play the several different versions of a broken down self as well as her original confident self.
Yeah, and she has to scare the hell out of Basil Rathbone, which she does successfully.
Scared the hell out of me.
Well, let's see what Clive Hirshhorn thought of Stolen Holiday, shall we?
All right.
Claude Rains' impeccable performance as a Russian fortune hunter, the model of which was clearly the real-life Alexandre Stavisky, was the prime reason for seeing Stolen Holiday. Story by Virginia Kellogg and Warren Duff, screenplay by Casey Robinson, which is not all that dissimilar in content to the Bayonne pawn shop scandal that took place in France. Kay Francis was also in it, and the collection of gowns she was obliged to wear throughout Hal Wallace's sumptuous production was another reason for seeing the movie. For the rest, this story of a Parisienne model who marries swindler Rains to protect him from the long arm of the law was really rather ordinary. Michael Curtiz was the director, and his cast included Ian Hunter as the man to whom Kay turns after husband Rains is murdered, Allison Skipworth, Alex Darcy, Charles Halton, Frank Riker, Frank Conroy, and Egon Brecher, also star.
He's got it in for your beloved Kay.
Yeah, I hate this guy.
You're calling him out. So Ian Hunter, did he replace George Brent as her co-star once George Brent moved on to Betty Davis?
Well, no, because Ian Hunter also helps out with Betty Davis at times, right?
Does he?
He's in The Sisters. We're going to see him in several Betty Davis movies as well.
I've seen The Sisters once. I liked it, but he didn't make an impression on me there. He did make an impression on me in Strange Cargo.
Well, yes, that's his best role for sure.
So let's talk about the players in this film and whether it is really rather ordinary. So we've got Michael Curtiz just before he becomes a A-list director.
Well, no, he was already an A-list director.
Yeah, but he really moves into a new league in 1938 with The Adventures of Robin Hood,
where Ian Hunter plays Richard the Lionheart, important scene at the end of the movie.
Also in that same year, he does Four Daughters and Angels with Dirty Faces, so the hits keep coming.
It's true, Curtiz, his star ascends after Mervyn LeRoy leaves Warner Brothers, but Curtiz was making great movies at Warner's throughout the 30s.
Screenwriter Casey Robinson,
King's Row,
and is also responsible for many of the greatest Betty Davis screenplays.
Yes.
So he does Dark Victory and now Voyager.
He's a great writer.
Really, we have very A-list talent on hand here, along with Claude Rains, of course. And we've got Curtiz and Claude Rains starting to work together very fruitfully. We also have, although this doesn't become clear until the end of the movie, because I was watching it and going, this is a weird little movie. What is it doing? I don't understand what it's trying to do with all of these characters. But it becomes clear by the end that even though his regular screenwriters are not on hand, the Epsteins, that already the Curtiz triangle is here.
He likes the triangle.
He likes the triangle, and his take on the triangle is not like anybody else's take on the triangle.
No, it's often a triangle with several good options.
And how does he do this? Because he's not even speaking English, correct? He's just screaming at people? How is he having this influence over his screenplays?
No, I think that's
an exaggeration.
He had an accent, and he used some malapropisms, but he also was a brilliant guy who had a good understanding of story construction, not just camera work. He spoke English and understood the scripts he was shooting, and the proof is right there, as you say.
Yep, there you go. Yet again, the auteur stamp emerges, even from a director who is not known to have contributed to his screenplays. I mean, ever since you introduced me to Four Daughters.
And Daughters Courageous.
Like, it's, yeah, all of those Daughters movies, it's become more and more clear what his special gifts as a, or what his special interests are as an auteur. He really is just as much. And another thing this anticipates is Mildred Pierce in its portrayal of a career woman. He really is just as much a woman's picture director as a hard-boiled Warner's director, which is how they come together so beautifully in Casablanca.
Well, the same year he did Mountain Justice, which is an amazing movie as well, with Josephine Hutchinson taking on the Ku Klux Klan and her abusive father as well.
Oh my.
Great movie. So many good Curtiz movies. He had worked with Kay Francis before. Mandalay is an interesting movie. Stavisky, by the way, that's one of the only things that I would take out of this Clive Hirschhorn review. I think he's right about that. Alain René made a film called Stavisky in the 70s, which is really interesting, about this affair as well, but using the real historical names.
Oh yeah, that I didn't know about.
An important part is played in this film by Alison Skipworth,
who I recognized as the one-eyed woman who with her one eye only sees gold from Devil is a Woman. Very memorable character cameo.
And in 1936, she played the Sydney Greenstreet role in Satan Metal Lady.
Yeah, she obviously had unique gifts to bring to the screen.
But here she's a supportive sidekick.
Although she kind of gets punished at the end for her interference. She is set a little too hard against Claude Rains, despite the fact that she is the fortune teller, she isn't able to see the inner gifts he possesses, as Kay Francis is. So it's interesting that she is this sort of plot device character who gets dumped at the end.
Well, she doesn't.
Not being a good enough plot device.
Maybe, but I don't get the sense that their association is over, but she doesn't get to go along on their honeymoon or whatever they're going to do right now. Hopefully she'll be back.
Well, I think it represents Kay Francis not trying to foretell the future anymore, perhaps?
Maybe, yeah. She's just gonna go with it. This film, too, it's not flashback, but it does speed through the years to get us through a progression of time, right? We meet Kay Francis as a model and fashion clothes horse at a Paris establishment, and she and her friends are all talking over what the future holds for them. She would like to get out of that racket and open up her own establishment.
She's specifically very mannish. They're drawing on that side of the Kay Francis persona that she could put on at will.
Right, there's a customer that actually remarks upon her hairstyle being mannish.
Adopting that kind of swagger with Alison Skipworth.
Right, but Skipworth says, you're not fooling anyone. You're just a big softie. And it's going to get you into trouble.
Right, and it does. Now, by the way, this movie looks stunning.
Yes.
Absolutely stunning. It feels like obviously Curtiz makes good looking movies, but it feels like already the Warner's house style for women's pictures and noirish melodramas, it's already in place now. And that's going to become so pronounced by the 1940s that their A pictures kind of direct themselves. They don't even need a remarkable director. Masterpieces are being made as if just by the studio itself, like Curtis Bernhardt's Possessed, like
Duke Girl,
now Voyager. We can name a lot of them, right? But here we do have a great director.
Yeah.
Who, of course, his masterpieces are going to be coming up in the 40s as well, Casablanca and Mildred Pierce.
And we have some very ominous stuff at the beginning. There are some interesting echoes between the two films. Is Claude Rains some kind of evil Lothario like Basil Rathbone, misrepresenting things? But he actually isn't. In the same way at all, anyway.
But he never can be either because he is the pipsqueak.
That's true. He's too small.
As Ian Hunter remarks.
He's pointedly very much shorter than Kay Francis. Like she was 5'9", I think.
But there were lots of... I don't really know about Claude Rains and how he got started in film. I didn't look that up for this. Do you know anything about it? I didn't look it up for this episode. I was researching
other
things.
He was a stage actor and he wound up... He was probably in a few things in England and they cast him in The Invisible Man for his amazing voice. And he became a star based on that.
Because plenty of short men became leading men.
Yeah, but he was also middle-aged already by the time he got to Hollywood. He was in his mid-40s, right? So
you could do either or, but not both, because Herbert Marshall sometimes was able to play a leading man despite being ancient.
Well, he doesn't look... He still looks youthful. Claude Rains...
But Claude Rains is, infinitely charming.
He is.
He appears in film And here's this is a great example of what he can do, this film, because he acts virtually the same way, whether he's playing an extremely good guy or an extremely bad guy. And in this movie, he kind of goes from one to the other.
I agree.
But he never changes his performance, which is just to be charming.
Well, I think you're not giving the whole picture here, because there were films where he played the villain to the hilt, right? Like in Adventures of Robin Hood or Antony Adverse. Those movies, he's just vicious.
But he's better.
He's not charming.
But he's better at playing a character who's either a bit ambiguous, like this one, or in Casablanca, a character who is awful.
He's morally bankrupt,
but,
for sure.
And yet he's still sympathetic.
Well, yeah, I agree. Those
or
movies.
Not, I don't know if he's even sympathetic, but he's likable.
Those movies are much greater in my mind than, you know, Antony Adverse or or even Robin Hood.
I mean, obviously he gets to play a straightforward villain sometimes because he's British. That's
exactly.
The only reason.
Robin Hood has Rathbone and Claude Rains being completely psychopathic.
I probably mentioned this before, but Betty Davis adored him, and her fan fiction, well, because he was such a good actor, and her fan fiction for Now Voyager was that obviously after Charlotte had gotten over Jerry, she was going to marry Jackwith.
Sure, of course.
Which is a great fan fiction for
that
movie.
That's what everyone would like.
When they're sitting together, they're having the hot dogs. It's the beginning of a great friendship. Well, they already have a great friendship. Beginning of a great romance.
Yeah, I mean, Claude Rains could do just about anything, but obviously the best spot for him, the place that utilized the most unique skills that he had, was this ambiguous, sympathetic,
of course,
charming
Notorious,
man.
Another perfect example,
sure,
of that, right? Where he, again, is thoroughly evil, but also, because Hitchcock wants to play with our point of view and perspective, also a sympathetic character.
Yeah, because he's...
Because of his position in the plot as the cuckolded...
He's being misled.
...man, yeah.
In Juarez, he's Napoleon III, but Napoleon III as the devil, which is what Betty Davis sees when she has her freak-out scene. He could play, and don't forget, the same year he's also playing the absolutely amoral, career-minded district attorney in They Won't Forget, whipping everyone up into a lynch mob frenzy. He's not charming in that movie.
It would be interesting to see him do something like the Jules Berry character in Le Jour Se Lève. You almost could see him doing that.
Well, he might have at some point. I mean, he played the devil a few times. I know that. Like Angel on My Shoulder, he's the devil. He played Heavenly Emissaries as well. That exact type of character who just is a wannabe minor devil. Maybe not.
Shall we get into this story?
So their meet cute is he comes in and picks her out of a lineup. He claims to be the confidential secretary to a duchess, and some clothes are needed at the duchess's mansion. Kay Francis is the one who has the same build as the duchess. I don't think any aristocrats had Kay Francis's build. They were too decrepit for that.
I don't think anybody had Kay Francis's build.
Not in Hollywood. She was the biggest woman in Hollywood.
And then she wears those dramatically low-cut gowns that show off her football shoulders. But it's kind of sexy anyway, because they're so low cut.
Yeah, those aren't my favorite Kay Francis outfits.
They might be mine.
Well, you know, to each their own. But yes, she's the only one that could wear those clothes at all. This idea, like Clive Hirshhorn, man, this guy is off the mark talking about Kay Francis. You don't write a book on Warner Brothers without doing your homework on Kay Francis. He's just repeating the old nostrums about how she's a clothes horse and she's not an actress. It's upsetting.
So one of the most important elements in a Warner Brothers woman's picture of this era, I don't know if he keeps going into the 1940s.
Oh, I'm pretty sure he does.
Orry-Kelly.
Yeah.
Responsible for some of the weirdest clothes ever seen on some of the weirdest women's bodies ever seen, such as Betty Davis in Dark Victory. You know that little low-cut outfit with the hat, with the cap? She has a few cap outfits in that movie, actually. And when I was a teenager watching Betty Davis movies...
She has that all-fur dress.
Yeah, I would just... Because I'd watch them over and over and over again, taped on VHS, off TV. Some viewings, I would just stare at the clothes. And it wasn't exactly admiration, it was fascination. It was like, what the hell is she wearing and why? Kate Francis's clothes would definitely have been in that category if I'd seen this movie as a teenager.
Yeah, well, you probably should have, but the world was not ready to show enough Kay Francis movies.
I'm sure now, if people are growing up on TCM, they must show a lot of Kay Francis movies.
Yeah, so again, I'm not, maybe I sound like a voice in the wilderness, but if you look into the classic film community, you will see I am certainly not alone. There are many, many huge Kay Francis fans, and I think her time is coming. The general public will be made aware of her greatness.
Orry-Kelly does the costume design for, your favorite, The Strawberry Blonde, for Now Voyager, for Casablanca.
Basically for all of the Warner Brothers movies up until the mid-40s, I think.
Orry-Kelly is a major part of my evolution into a cinephile as a teenager.
When she gets to this palatial estate, it's all in mothballs, basically. It's not lived in. It's quite eerie. Again, there's this vague sense of threat, but it's undercut by the fact that, again, she looks like she could beat Claude Rains up if she needs to.
He's a tiny, tiny little man next to her.
And he's acting like everything's normal, and he takes her into a room and asks her to put on the same gown again, because that's the one that the Duchess wants to see, and she calls him on it finally and says, "There's no one here but us, so what's going on? Why are we here? Are you planning to attack me?" And then he says, no, I've got a plan. I've got a proposition for you. It does not involve me attacking you, but listen.
Now, already at this point, you have to start wondering about subtext here and whether he isn't already in love with her.
Well, clearly he picked her because he thought this is the ideal woman and this is what's going to impress everyone else. This she conforms to an idea he had in his mind.
This big, mannish woman who could wipe the floor with me.
Right. And when
who's also, incredibly sweet, as he learns this night.
Yeah, and when he puts it to her in exactly the right way, in his charming manner, he says, look, I'm taking a chance here. You're going to be meeting some big financiers. If at any point it sounds like I'm doing something that you don't agree with morally, just tell them I'm a big liar.
She's incredibly sweet, but also incredibly ambitious.
Yes, and bright. And again, not that many actresses could play all of this so believably.
Sure, yeah, I agree.
Kay Francis is one of the ultimate, career ladder climbing actresses of the 30s. Seems exactly right. It's not forced in any way. And they've had these discussions on the way to the mansion. She talks about what her plans are. So he has a good sense of what she's like, what she's planning for, how they both need capital, and she goes along with it.
What I mean about Alison Skipworth being a plot device that's discarded or punished at the end for not being a good enough plot device is that I mean that she forecasts the expected plot, but the movie decides to throw out the expected plot.
Yeah, she says the Black King is going to fuck you up. And Kay Francis takes that to mean that she's going to fall in love with the absolutely wrong man. And in fact, that's not what happens. She develops a great, genuinely great friendship with the wrong man. That's what happens.
And again, you would never see this.
I've never seen a movie like this.
No, but
there's no other story like this.
No, there isn't. But also, it's strongly related to the relationship, for example, that Priscilla Lane develops with John Garfield in Four Daughters, and strongly related to aspects of the triangle. Ingrid Bergman is basically best friends with Paul Henri in Casablanca.
Yeah, she admires him. It has nothing to do. His qualities are not at all like Claude Rains' qualities here, because Claude Rains is not. But he's many things, but he's not noble.
But this is the triangle that Curtiz likes.
Sure.
Where the woman is in love with one man and friends with, but be friends beyond friendship. Not just friends with, but devoted to another man.
Yeah, BFFs.
Yeah. And willing to make sacrifices for him, willing to sacrifice her love for him, the man she loves for him, right? And on his side, he's in love with her, and yet somehow undeserving in some way, right? Or feels like he's undeserving in some way, or actually is.
Yeah, and that is certainly what you get in Four Daughters, because the relationship that builds up between Priscilla Lane and John Garfield, obviously it was so good that they had to pair them romantically for real a few more times after this, but in that movie, no, they are just really good friends. And that's how she wants it to be.
But he's in love with her.
Right. But for her, she just wants this really close relationship with this weird guy and to have her husband on the side that she's romantically interested in.
And again, Kay Francis basically is, she's the Curtiz heroine. So she's similar to Priscilla Lane and to Ingrid Bergman in that she's really, really nice.
Yep.
And yet she's complicated. She's emotionally complicated. That's how she gets involved in these triangles.
Yeah. So the years speed by after that. They succeed, right? And he does set her up with her own Pico and Company, which is an echo of Collet and Company, I guess, as well. Trouble in Paradise, her perfume empire. Here, it's a clothing empire, but both in Paris. And she has no idea that anything untoward has occurred. She just thinks this guy's a financial genius. And obviously he is, but he's been doing some things that go beyond the strictly legal. He has his own perspective on that, which we learn later on, that of course, under capitalism, whatever you can get away with is what's correct, right? Because it's all morally dubious.
Yeah, well, I was thinking about that as I was watching this. What is he doing exactly? Is he screwing over ordinary people? And who are the mob that attack her clothing store later?
Okay, what happened here is that I'm going by the movie here, but I think I know a tiny bit about the Stavisky affair, but I don't know the details. But what the movie is saying is that they own all these pawn shops. They've got a monopoly on pawn shops.
Yeah.
And what they're doing is keeping replicas, paste replicas of jewelry, and then they are using that to fuel other enterprises that are also a little bit shady as well, or very shady, including these junk bonds that they're getting into.
Because, you know, the reason that you, or we, as we just realized in our last viewing, are able to root for the Scorsese character in The Wolf of Wall Street, never mind what the real Jordan Belfort was like, is because he quickly stops screwing over the little person and is screwing only rich people, right? And then, like, who cares what he does? I mean, he has personally unpleasant habits, but who cares what he's doing in his career? It's fine.
The thing that gets out of hand with the Stavisky affair is that it is, I believe, it is what precipitated the financial panics and crises that go beyond the Great Depression in France in the mid-1930s, which is what almost led to the fascist takeover of the state in 1934 and 35, right? All the stuff that we were talking about with Renoir when he got involved with the Popular Front. It was because there were riots and mass unrest due to the even worse financial destabilization brought about by the Stavisky crisis.
Because of these junk bonds.
Yeah. So it's all,
so
I guess,
who are
accurate
these, who
to
are these
the
investors who become part of this mob? Are these just middle class people?
You mean his associates, his lieutenants?
No, I'm talking about the mob that attacks her store.
Well, those are just people who are being thrown out of work because there's a financial panic. And they're saying, oh, it's all because of this. And I guess in some sense it is, right? So it's like people in 2008, 2009 getting angry because they lost their jobs. So they go and throw rocks at Goldman Sachs or something, which I don't think anybody did, but maybe they should have. So that's what they're trying to do here. They're trying to get at the only person who's still in business that they think has any association with Claude Rains, and it's K. Francis's store. But the newspapers have now made it clear what happened, and they know who they're scapegoating for this.
When he arranges this wedding with her so that they can invite all of these people who will be, all of these important officials who will then be implicated with him and therefore can't prosecute him, that was fascinating. That felt very modern. Thinking about, you know, the taint that now attaches to anybody, which is literally every rich person and every celebrity who was ever at a party with
Jeffrey Epstein.
Or Prince Andrew, yeah.
Yeah, sure. All of the pedophile.
Yeah. Except here it's not pedophilia, it's junk bonds.
Well, not only that, though. It's basically the unspoken idea here, which Claude Rains, well, he does speak of it when he tells her about how they should get married. It's that all of these people, these well-placed officials in the French government, they buy clothing for their mistresses through K. Francis and send them off. There could be blackmail potential there as well, right?
So this extreme interest in corruption and how it ripples through a society, again, this seems to strongly anticipate Casablanca.
Yeah, and it's just pretty classic Warner Brothers to have such a jaded point of view on capitalism.
Yeah, that's another thing I was thinking about, how these movies, because we see a transition here around the time of Stolen Holiday into the glossy mode of the 1940s that's so different from their, and you know, a lot of it is women's pictures, investment in women's pictures, that's so different from their early proletariat mode, but that is a connection.
Sure. Yeah, it definitely persists. At the height of their glossiness in 1942, they do Juke Girl, which looks like a beautiful 1940s Warner Brothers film, but it really is a pro-communist film, straight up.
And for their male actors, John Garfield kind of takes the place of James Cagney and moves into noir mode.
Sure, well, Cagney was back by that point, and he was also in noir mode in a lot of cases.
True, yeah. And Humphrey Bogart also moves into noir mode in the 40s.
Indeed.
This is my question. How are we supposed to, if he's involved in this sort of, if he is the man responsible for the financial destabilization of the country, how are we supposed to feel about him?
Well, look, I think it's a problem with the system if one person committing fraud can destabilize the financial system. That means the financial system itself is a fraud. That's how I look at it. Now, I'm not sure if Warner Brothers would have put it exactly like that, but that's certainly how Claude Rains' character feels about it, right? This is all manipulation and gamesmanship.
And he is a nihilist.
Sure. Well,
that's how he talks, right? Morals change from day to day, et cetera, et cetera.
Financial and economic morals.
Well, yeah, because he turns out to not be a nihilist in just the one respect that he is in love with Kay Francis and values her opinion of him because they are friends.
He's very Machiavellian in the way he set up his business structure. He's got all his little cat's paws, and we hear about it throughout the film that even if he loses some of the lower level pieces on the board, they still can't implicate him directly. And it's only if it gets to a certain point that he has to run away.
But of course, he's so much more fun than his cowering lackeys that you end up enjoying the fact that he's feeding them to the wolves.
Yeah, well, he tells them, look, that's what I'm paying you for. You're just there to go to jail if things go wrong in your part of the business.
It is very...
That's all you're doing, is sitting there waiting to go to jail if you have to.
It's very Scorsesean, isn't it? The only person he actually considers his equal, and again, this is fascinating, this writing by Casey Robinson, the only person he actually considers his equal is Kay Francis, and she is the one that he wants to have a real heart-to-heart with when it looks like maybe he's going to be going to jail. And none of these men does he consider his equal.
No.
And then he even tells his first lieutenant, that when a man, what does he say?
Well, that's his, like, kind of private secretary. It's the guy that plays the music teacher in The Awful Truth.
Okay. But anyway, he tells him when a man is in real trouble, he doesn't turn to another man, he turns to a woman. Again, that's an utterly unique perspective from yeah. Michael Curtiz, isn't it?
Yeah. And then in the midst of all of this evolving gloom on the economic and criminal front, which Kay Francis is oblivious of during all of this part of the film, she needs a rest. Claude Rains says he's going to take a rest too. They go to Switzerland, and there she meets Ian Hunter, who she's had one brush with in Paris, and he insulted her outfit.
Right.
And she doesn't mind that. She knows that's all a game. She thinks of the fashion world the way Claude Rains thinks of the capitalist structure in general, right? It's all just, what can you put over?
Yes, right.
Which I like as well, right? You know, she's not stuffy about it. She's just like, look, you got to keep the styles coming. The crazier, the better. Whatever causes people to talk is a victory.
Yep.
Really brilliant dialogue on that score and beautifully put across by Kay Francis. And she does need this little break, runs into Ian Hunter. A lot of it is masterminded by Alison Skipworth or opportunistically arranged by Alison Skipworth when she realizes he's on their plane.
Well, this is the man that she wants for Kay Francis.
The Red Jack. So she gets him talking during the plane trip. By the end of all of that, they're ready to start getting to know each other better. Claude Rains is off making phone calls to see which of his lieutenants are in jail. He doesn't have time to actually go skiing or hiking or whatever they might have done if he was more at liberty. And we already know that she's not in love with him.
Yep.
He's asked her a few times about that, and it's still no, no on that score. She's too focused on her career. But of course, Ian Hunter goes to a place in her heart that she hasn't admitted was there.
Yeah, it's all pretty fun, but I'm afraid that... I mean, I find Four Daughters is a little more balanced for me, because it just devotes so much energy to putting across the initial romance. Priscilla Lane's initial romance.
With Felix.
Even though, of course, I favor John Garfield because he's John Garfield and he's dark, still, the idyll with Felix and all of the other daughters, all of the sisters, is put across very convincingly.
All of which, again, never hurts for me to mention, was an invention of Curtiz and his screenwriters, because Fanny Hurst's story is absolute grimness from beginning to end with a clown, a suicidal clown. And none of that stuff that we love in the Four Daughters film is really in the story it was based on.
But you love it anyway.
Well, it's a great story, but it has nothing to do with that movie.
But here, you can't help but root for Claude Rains because he's Claude Rains. Even though this relationship is clearly impossible.
Yeah, well, she just doesn't feel the right way about him.
If she did, he's...
He's going to jail.
He's completely corrupt.
Or he has to leave the country.
They don't really see eye to eye here.
No, and we're not just talking about heights.
Jeez.
And I can make these jokes because I'm the same height as Claude Rains. But the movie makes a point of it over and over again that he's a pipsqueak and this is a problem. Although she does take offense on his part when Ian Hunter calls him a pipsqueak.
And by the end of it, where they're having their final tete-a-tete in the cabin that he's retreated to, Claude Rains, that is, there's this whole enigma, again, that gets explored more in Four Daughters, over what hold this man has over this apparently really nice woman. Now, in Four Daughters, it's much more simple. She wants to mother him. It's really, the psychology of it is really explored. This movie doesn't explore her psychology. And so, but that can be good too, because then it's left enigmatic and it can be very interesting to speculate about what is it that has drawn this woman to this man. But she seems to have nothing in common with other than their ambition.
I think that's it, right?
They're what is the bond of friendship that continues between them?
Well, it's solidified in their mutual amazement that they were able to put this over and get going on the careers that they've always wanted, right? And they've obviously been encouraging each other every step of the way. A lot of it is left off screen, but they discuss it enough, I think, at various points, how much they owe to each other and how much it's just basically become habit to help each other out and push each other onward whenever they can. I think the movie does enough to establish that, even though they're obviously coming at their view of society is not exactly in sync, but the subject position they were coming in, I mean, he's an immigrant from Russia, obviously coming from a very difficult position to try to establish himself, and she's a model, right? She's not considered to be anything in that society. She's just there to wear clothes, and she's not supposed to be a player, an economic player, and she wants to be.
Yeah, and
she
that's is. The Mildred Pierce aspect.
That's right.
But what we find out in that final scene between the two of them is that even after she learns the worst about him,
that's right,
she is still willing to, she still values this friendship so much that she is willing to help him escape.
Yeah, her major disappointment is that he didn't tell her the truth about all of it, that he made these gestures toward a more superficial relationship where she would have to believe he was innocent to help him. And she says, no, that's not what our friendship is like. If you're cheating people with junk bonds and paste jewelry, you should have just told me that in the first place, and I could have been a more effective ally to you. I thought we were really getting married to help you get out of these false accusations, and now you're telling me they're true?
Now, does this...
That's the problem.
Does this mean she doesn't have a moral compass after all? Or...
Well, I just think her devotion to him is more important to her than whether people play by the rules getting ahead under capitalism.
It's more important to her than anything, even her romantic love. And it's interesting to see how that turns into something, you know, much more understandable and sort of conventional in Casablanca, which is a woman who hero worships the man that she's with, right?
Yeah.
And that is the basis of their relationship. But this is something very different.
No, here he is another self for her, right? He is her getting ahead on a different track, but it's the same struggle that they're both facing. And that's why they're so close. Ian Hunter just comes out of nowhere. He's a British diplomat. He's someone that she can fall in love with. She can have romantic ideas about. He has nothing to do with her. He's not like her in any way. And they actually talk about that. at their first dinner together, Ian Hunter actually says, hey, we have nothing in common. We have nothing to talk about. That's something for us to work towards, isn't it? And they manage to do
it. That's true, yeah.
I actually like that scene where they wind up at that cabin and they, you know, they bond over not killing
Dubs,
the squab.
That's true. It's pretty charming.
Those scenes are good, I think, yeah. Right? I don't think this is as great a movie as Four Daughters, but I really, really like it. And I think that that idyllic time there at that cabin, it does serve just as well as the family picnic.
And then we see something really remarkable, which I've rarely ever seen on film, ever, which is that Claude Rains' character actually changes in front of our eyes.
He's a great actor.
It's a pretty amazing coup, but it's a writing coup as well.
Yeah.
Although you would need a great actor to pull it off. In front of our eyes, in the moment, listening to her, he realizes that he can only make himself worthy of her friendship by changing into a better person.
And he knows what's coming, too.
And this is what Priscilla Lane wants to do for John Garfield and can't in Four Daughters. She wants him to see the potential that she sees in him and transform into that. Of course, Claude Rains can only transform into that by killing himself.
Well, he doesn't kill himself.
I know, but he knows he's going to die.
Yes, he walks into a bullet, but that's what John Garfield does too, right? That's his transformation in The Four Daughters. It's that he kills himself.
Wants. That's not what she wants from him, though. She wants him to transform into somebody who can be a functioning member of society.
Yeah, but he doesn't think he can do that. What he can do is let her be a functioning member of society by marrying the person that she wanted to marry in the first place. So he has to leave the stage.
They're two, like, utterly unique relationship portrayals in a woman's picture in those two, in this film and that one.
Yeah. And the final act for Claude Rains, as you mentioned, right? Like, he sees the police have arrived, led by his old crony, who has turned on him and has made a deal. And he knows what's going to happen. He knows he's going to be killed
and of course
trying to escape.
And of course, the police are as corrupt as he is. And
absolutely. This is a film noir. Government, there's nothing moral going on there. It's just a bunch of deals being cut. The scandals that have rocked the French state during the mid-1930s, the people who are really responsible for it are still in place at the end. And Claude Rains is he was willing to sacrifice others, and here he gets sacrificed himself by his police pal who shoots him. The movie doesn't leave that to our guests, right? Because he actually talks about how you got to change the place where the gun is when we're taking
the
picture.
That's an amazing, not ending, but it should be the film's ending. However,
and I think that is pretty much how people theorize that Stavisky went out, like killed by one of his own friends before he could turn them all in and create an even worse scandal where the entire government, every bureaucrat basically was out.
So Kay Francis ends up losing her business.
It was built on corrupt foundations.
And it kind of seems like Ian Hunter wants her to become a housewife at the end.
It seems quite possible, yeah.
So what happened to her ambition? It dies with Claude Rains?
Yeah, well, that is a problem, right? She's obviously taken a blow that all of her advancement that she achieved, you know, it's all tied up with this mess.
So it kind of really sours this idea of her getting together with Ian Hunter, despite how much fun we've seen them have together. And I mean, she's going to have some kind of a happy life, but it does feel like a mutilation of her character. And I think that's got to be intended.
I think so. Yeah, she's now going to be stuck being what Claude Rains intended her to be in their scheme and their scam at the beginning, right? Just as a sham hostess who's like a really impressive woman who can impress the men who are the real players. And that's right. What Ian Hunter says, you know, with you hosting my parties, I'm really going to get ahead as a diplomat now.
Whereas Claude Rains saw a kind of potential in her that I guess Ian Hunter didn't.
Well, Ian Hunter just doesn't think about that kind of stuff. Yeah, he doesn't even think about his career that much.
But he has one.
He has one, and he just takes it for granted that he should have one and she should help him with his career.
Yeah, it's a fascinating screenplay.
It is.
And a gorgeous looking movie.
Yeah, everyone should definitely watch both of these films because they're pretty interesting Warner Brothers entries for 1937.
I agree.
So next week on the podcast, we'll go back to Margaret Sullivan. This is part 4. We'll be talking about Three Comrades.
Great film.
And The Shopworn Angel.
I don't know that one as well, but it's going to reunite her with Jimmy Stewart.
Looking forward to it.
Yeah, me too.